So today, as David announced, I'm going to talk about productionizing ML with Spark. It's not as exciting as deep learning, I get that, but bear with me, it can be quite exciting. So first, a little bit about Depop. So Depop is a fashion marketplace and a social marketplace where we take young creative and people that want to build something and we help transform fashion and the way we see fashion today. So roughly a few numbers, they're a bit old, so it's probably a little bit more than that today. But we roughly have 4 million monthly active users, 120K distinct products listed every day, and 30K sell per day. So let's start with data science. So I've been doing that for about 7 years, and plus my years of uni, one, it makes me very old, and two, I've been seeing that for so long that it kind of gets boring. But one of the things I noticed is that it's a beautiful diagram, but it's all about the model. It's all about taking some data, processing it, doing some analysis, getting a model out, doing some visualization, giving some sort of business insight, and that's where it stops. So at Depop, we believe that it shouldn't be the end of it, because the value of everything that is done in that diagram is actually in putting it out there and making it available to power your app, your website, or whatever else you're doing. So the way we do it at Depop, and it's a lot less nice in terms of colors and all that, but a lot more efficient, is we start by designing a solution to a business problem. We do some analysis again. We do feature extraction. We train a model, and then we productionize. And then we go for monitoring and serving the inference to whatever platform we want. So what I'm going to talk about is the productionization part. And I'm going to talk about how we do it at Depop. So we have a few different ways of doing it at Depop. So depending on what kind of model you have and what kind of input you give to that model, you actually have different ways. So first, if you have an event and you have, for example, a computer vision model that just takes an image and tells you, you know, is it a good image or a bad image? You will just have an event that gives you, for example, an URL, and you just go fetch the picture from that, and that's just event base. And then you have everything you need in that event. For that, we've got a generic ML service. Takes an event, spit out a prediction. And if you want to know more, we've got a great engineering blog that explains everything about that model, and there's a link on the slide, so hopefully you get the slides and you can look at that. But that's the address for the blog. Now, the second way is actually using Spark to use historical data. So if, for example, you have a model that relies on historical data that needs to be aggregated and done by batches, then you can actually use that kind of solution. And that's the one I'm going to talk about. The third one is when you have something that is so specific that you actually need a bespoke solution. And that's the moment where it's a little bit of everything and anything can come from there. And we have solutions like that too. So let's talk about the Spark version of it. So how does it work? So here's an overview. It's a very high-level overview. But the way it works is we've got some code somewhere, mostly a S3 bucket. We've got some models that are trained offline. And then we have a framework that starts on your ML cluster with Spark, gets your data from a data lake, and run the processing, run the prediction, and spit it out to an output back to your data lake so we can keep track of those data, and also potentially to our message broker, RabbitMQ. But basically, at this point, where we put those prediction is basically depending on what we want to do. It doesn't really matter if we want to do RabbitMQ or something else. It is actually all possible. So let's talk about this code that lives in a S3 bucket. So what we call it is a model repository. So what is a model repository? So it's a version control, standardized artifact repository, including all necessary parts to run a model and run inference with a model that has been trained offline. So that's a mouthful. So what does it mean is that it's a version control, so it lives in GitHub. It's standardized, as in it follows a structure that is always the same. And it includes all code to run the model and also the model itself and all its dependencies to be able to run that. And so when you put it back in your new environment you're creating in Spark, you have everything you need to run it. So what does it look like? So as I said, there's a model. It's often trained offline. It might be a Python model. It might be a classic kind of ML model in scikit-learn. It might be a Keras model if you do deep learning or any kind of model. It might be even like some graph processing or something else, anything. So we serialize that. Either we pickle it, Keras has a very own way of saving it, or anything else that is possible under the sun, and we keep that model. We have what we call a bootstrap action. So bootstrap action is when you start your cluster, you actually have a bash script that runs and will do something to all the nodes and the master in that cluster. So basically, the main point of a bootstrap action is to actually install all the dependencies you actually need to run those models. You've got a main file. And those names are actually quite important. The main.py needs to be a main.py. You can't call it main.topseller.py. It won't work because the structure needs to be standardized. So the main.py is actually the main part of the model. It's like how you train the model, how you run this model. So how you when you got all your data you wanted and you do the inference, that's how you do it. And then you have what we call a manifest, which is basically a JSON file that gives you all the information necessary to run the model. So let's say you've got an application name for Spark. That's where you find it. You've got a job name. You've got a version for the job, but you also have a version for the model because you might improve your model. It requires the same data, but it's a different model. So you can say you can change the version one without the other, and it makes it a lot more flexible. You can also have the key for the RabbitMQ key you need to the routing key for it. So you have all the information you need in that small file, and then if you go to the model repository, you can read this file and actually understand what is the model is doing, where you find the files, and how you run that. So the way we deploy those models is we actually use Jenkins. People like it, people might not, but that's what we use. And so the way it works is like a three-step project kind of a pipeline. So we fetch the data, we fetch the code and the files from a S3 bucket that is a work in progress. We run some tests on it. So let's say we check if there's a main.py, if we do have requirement, if the manifest is actually the right format and it has all the information you need and so on and so on. If the version that is currently being deployed is actually existing or not, so we don't overwrite it, and so on and so on. And then after that, if everything is fine, all the text checks, then we can release it to a release bucket, which is the production bucket. So when we talk about that specific framework, it's a kind of a two-step project. First, you have to create the full thing. And by the full thing, I mean the infrastructure that helps run that. And then once it's done, the pain is gone. And you can use it in about 10 minutes. So that's the nicest part of it. So let's talk about the pain first, and I'll show you the nice stuff at the end. So the main part is actually the Lambda. The Lambda is is the code that defines the full framework, basically. So we use Butter 3. Because we are an AWS shop, we use Butter 3 as an EMR client, and that runs a run job flow function that basically tells you, I want an EMR cluster, I want it that way, and I want to run that. So what the job is doing is you run the Python file. The first step is run the bootstrap action to get those requirements in. Two, fetch whatever you need from the repository. And three, run the Spark submit on your main.py. And your job is done because From there, it will spit out whatever was in the main.py, which is all your prediction to either a bucket, data lake, rabbit, and so on and so on. So what does a run job flow look like? So it looks a little bit like that. It's not pretty, it's not easy to read, but it's actually pretty simple in the concept. So you install Spark on your cluster, it's kind of nice. You say where you want to get some logs, because it's always important to get that. You define the cluster you want, so the type of your masters, the number of slaves, the type of your slaves, if you want some specific volume on it, and so on. The steps, it's just a bunch of, it's a list of a bunch of steps you run. So you fetch the code, so we go to a S3 bucket, and we just go and fetch whatever is in that part. And then we fetch the model itself, which is in another directory. We fetch just that. And then we install some latest requirement if we need some specific one on the master. And then we just say, run the final step. So the reason why here it's not Spark Summit to main.py is because we made it even agnostic to just running a Python job. So the final step, basically, you just say, I want a Python job, and then you run Python 3, whatever job you want, and or you can do a Spark Summit. So to go even further, we went for being agnostic to even like being Spark or just Python. And the beauty of it is, once you've done all that, you can actually go and deploy any kind of model with that. So you just basically instantiate your Lambda using your Terraform module you just built by changing the job name you need, telling which is the, which one of the environment you're going to go for, production versus staging, saying exactly what type of instance you want, what type of master, slave, how many of them do you want, and also some of the specific information about executor and memory size and so on and so on that you tune in the before that. And you've got a cron-like scheduling. So basically, you tell your job, I want it to run every day at 7 o'clock, or I want it to run 3 times a day at 3 hours difference or something, whatever it is, really. You can choose whatever scheduling you want, as long as you kind of want your job to not overlap too much, because it can become somewhat of a problem. But if your job is well optimized, it shouldn't be any problem with that. And that's it for me.